Good afternoon to you, class. My name is Mugiru Richard, lecturer in the Faculty of Business. I'm going to take you in the course called Business Statistics. And before I start, I think you've already got exposed to the course outline, which I posted some time back on your platform. So, and what I would I know is that being your second semester, first semester of second year, you must have studied quantitative methods, business statistics. It's statistics and quantitative methods, also is statistics. So you may find that some of the course units which you are going to study in business statistics, you have already covered them in quantitative methods. Then you would ask why then study business statistics. We are going to see that business statistics comprise of contribution of statistical methods used to analyze business data with the intention of making inference, that is, conclusions. You will be exposed to approaches which use statistical analysis, sample data, and use of results to make decisions from a well-informed point of view, so that you don't reason, jump to conclusions without empirical evidence, without data, without giving information which is well researched. The course will develop you into managers who are able to apply statistical methods to enable you make rational decisions using sample data. So the learning outcomes at the end of the course, you will be expected to have knowledge about the nature and scope of business statistics. You also have knowledge about various sources of statistical data collection. You also be able to use sampling techniques and estimation methods. You also be able to carry out multivariate analysis using applied mathematical theories needed in decision making. Position to use index number, construction, the past year, and laissez faire index numbers, and learn how to the National Consumer Price Index is constructed. So, we also study the behavior of the series data, the seasonality trend analysis, and forecasting of the series with emphasis on the multiplicative model and additive models. So the books were also shown to you, required readings, which you will be using, going to the library or access on internet. So we are going to start with the introduction of the course, which I'm doing now. Meaning of business statistics, nature and scope of business statistics, importance and limitations of statistics. We shall see sample size determination, data collection and analysis methods, and then sampling in general. So this week, where we are starting today, that's what we are going to cover. Then we will study distributions, estimation and hypothesis testing for the mean and populations. We will study analysis of variance. Then you will start the distribution estimation and hypothesis testing. Then analysis of variance. Then next you will study the chi-square test. Then further probability, because you have already studied probability and quantitative methods. This time around, we shall go further into probability. Then we will study correlation and regression, which you have already covered, but you also have details. Then we studied time series analysis, and we studied index numbers, then calculus of multivariable functions. That is a function with more than two variables, more than one variable. Then you will study calculus of, division, we'll do it this time around. So overall assessment is still the same. You got a Christian University, you have 50% coursework and 50% examination. definitely, if you get submission of coursework and blah blah, you will not be allowed. It's good enough. We are e-learning, whereby we shall just be timing you, giving you a date on when to submit, and afterwards we shall just close you out if you haven't submitted by time. I will bring in some other colleagues of mine to come and give you some lectures on some of these topics, because you've seen the entire course was addressed to me, Richard alone, but I'm going to bring you some other professors who are going to take you in different course units. So thank you very much. Let us get ready for the first lecture, which is statistics is an art and science of collecting, analyzing, and interpreting, presenting and interpreting data into useful information. So we shall do the data collection, the methods, blah blah, analysis and data, presenting, how do we present data, and how do we interpret data into useful information. Because as a suggestion, when you are doing business statistics, it is to help us really reason very empirically, basing on information that cannot be challenged. See, many people normally say, I think that is that, blah blah, and they don't base on empirical studies or evidence, that is using figures. And even when you come to, for example, to making choice, making a decision, for example, now we are in campaigns, you've heard about America, and now people are carrying the elections, blah blah blah, Trump. But statistics are there. Figures, they are the one who's reading, just showing them to, telling them that you got such and such a percentage, that is a statistic, and you should just cool down and relinquish the powers. So that is statistics. Decision making, for example, if you are to distribute books in primary schools, you have to have the figures, the statistics. How many are in such and such a district? How many? Why should we take more this way? In hospitals, blah blah, diseases are taken. They normally compile statistics about diseases, and then you have to order drugs according to what people suffer from. What the most? If they suffer from malaria more than diabetes, that means you have to import more drugs in which cure malaria. So data, we are still talking about data, collecting, blah blah, presenting, interpreting data. What is data? Data consists of the facts and figures that are collected and analyzed. So that's when we get facts become data. So types of data, some of these you people, students, you are going to read by yourselves. Compile your own notes. Don't think that what I'm going to deliver as a lecture is going to be conclusive enough. That's why we are giving you references in books. You go and read. So that in types of data, primary, stroke, secondary, you should know the difference between the two. Nominal stroke, ordinal, internal stroke, external, published stroke, unpublished data. Quantitative stroke, qualitative. That is not it. And the unquote quantitative is qualitative. So it's a quantitative stroke qualitative. Okay? Qualitative. So, but let me talk about maybe published and unpublished data. Publication, normally when you come and collect information and then compile it and blah blah, do the analysis, there are organizations, there are groups of people who have formed themselves into organizations of repute who read through what you have written. And in order to be recognized and the information which you definitely you don't just come up and write whatever you correct and say and write and say you are publishing, there are those who are recognized publishers. They read your information and then they put it on the internet worldwide so that the other people of repute can also read it and challenge it. So it goes into several challenges. You go into modifying here and there, and then you put it, and then those recognized groups of publishers, they okay it. So when it is okay, then you can go and publish and then put it on for recognized, has been recognized, and then for reading and also for use in anywhere, in any area where you have written. So it is not, you don't just wake up and then you write anything, put it on the internet and then you say you are published. No. And that's why you people, when you'll be doing research, when you come download on the internet and blah blah, not everything will be allowed, because some of the information which is there is just, some of it is trash. It's not allowed. So statistics can be, we mostly we shall deal with this descriptive statistics, which are the tabular, graphical, and numerical methods used in to summarize data. And the statistical inference is the use of data obtained from a sample to make estimates or test hypotheses about the characteristics of a population. Definitely, maybe sample and population. A sample is just a portion of the entire count that is used in statistics. And the population, you know, geographers define it differently. But for us statisticians, we say population is the entire count of any items under a study. So if you say we are going to count all the trees in Uganda Christian University main campus, that is the population of trees, not only dealing with people. But the sample, you will see, we use a sample in most of these studies, most of the researches, most of the what you want to find out, it's very difficult to use the entire population simply because of time and cost. So application of statistics in business and economics. Well, the accountants use it. Public accounting firms use statistical sampling procedures when conducting audits for their clients. When they are conducting audits for their clients, you cannot come to Uganda Christian University to audit it for an entire year. You are going to spend about 2 weeks and you say you will look at each and every voucher. So that's when we come into using the sampling procedures, which you are going to be exposed to. And before we expose you to sampling procedures, I would request you to read about sampling and the sampling methods and techniques. Why use a sample than a population? I've already told you that it's time-saving. Time-saving in terms of what? Because if you are going to audit accounts which have been there for a year, for 2 years, and you think you will take the same time, then you will not produce work in the stipulated time. And by the time you will produce that work, it will be time back, meaning that the usefulness of that information you are going to give has a marked time. So time saving. Yeah, 1 month for the work of a whole year, you have that means you have to do the sampling. You choose How to choose is another topic of another day, but that is using the sampling techniques. And so that you, the information which you are going to generate using a sample should not be challenged. Otherwise, if it is challenged and someone comes and says, no, it's not a representative information, meaning that you did not use representative sample, the information, the report which you are going to generate can be challenged and you will not accept it. So that's why you also be subject to sampling procedures, so that you know which methodology you are going to use, which sampling method are you going to use, so that the information which you've given within its shortest possible time is not challenged. It is also cheap. Cheap means it's very expensive, by the way, to do entire count. Like, for example, the census. Uganda itself as a country, you find that it is cannot afford it cannot afford sponsoring the census exercise. Census means taking the entire count of the objects. For example, counting of people, that is census, and all what information which is required thereof, you find that World Bank comes in to sponsor the country. Yeah, we go into borrowing. We get good people of good heart to give us a hand in order to sponsor. But that means you, that's why in accounting you cannot go into the entire county, because it's very expensive. It will be very expensive if an auditor comes and stays in an organization for 1 month, and then the organization pays around 10 million. But then you allow such a group of people come and stay for a whole year, then I don't know how much you will pay. So it is cheaper to use the sample. The auditor will draw conclusions from the sampled accounts, so that the conclusions should be representative enough of the entire. So in finance, financial analysts use a variety of statistical information to guide their investment recommendations by comparing financial data on price-stroke-earnings ratios. So they use that statistic information, statistical information, price-earnings ratio to guide investment recommendation. In marketing, statistics is used as analysis on the relationship between promotional activities, expenses, and sales. Marketing research statistics are used by marketeers in establishing future marketing strategies for various products. So those are all some of the uses of statistics. In production, emphasis on quality makes quality control an important application for statistics in production. In economics, the economists frequently provide forecasts. Use previous statistics about the future of the economy using a variety of statistical information in making such forecasting inflation rates, producer price index, unemployment rate, manufacturing forecast by using statistical that are entered into computerized forecasting models. A model is just a sort of like an equation which is built over time to stand to represent any information which you would like to generate out of it. Some of you did some physics. There's a model which converts the Fahrenheit degrees into Celsius degrees Fahrenheit, which I cannot remember, but I think you people, since you are still fresh more than me, you must be knowing that model. Okay, for us in economics, we have what we call the consumption model. Consumption is equal to C is equal to A plus BY, A which is autonomous consumption, and B is the marginal propensity to consume, and Y is the income level. So that one is a model. And someone of those people, economists who came out earlier than us, gave us that model. That if you want to calculate anyone's level of consumption, you must give that one an autonomous consumption, whereby then if income is zero, consumes that level. That is model. So we use those to predict, to forecast It is using past records. What has been happening, in fact, about unemployment rate? What has it been in Uganda for the previous 10 years? And then you predict what it will be in the next 5 or more so years. Such statistics are required by investors, those who are coming in this country. They will need these statistics, inflation rates, production price, producer price index, unemployment rate, manufacturing forecast. So those are required by any investor, or even you, if you want to do any business. I would request you that you go to Uganda Bureau of Statistics, which is the custodian of all these figures, and inquire, my friend, I want to invest in this and that. What is its turnover effect or impact? Using the last past statistics, the WUBOS can give you what it has been before, and you predict what will happen in the future. So with data collection methods, let us look at first of all the data sources existing. Existing sources for secondary data, we have the survey records. Secondary data is data which is already existing. Secondary data is data which is already existing. It was already collected, and now it is just ready for use. People collected it, you analyzed it, and then presented it. So that is secondary data. So it's very bad for you if you secondary data exists to go into looking for that information. Let me give an example. If you, as students, a group of students, and I want to know which schools you came from, what is your districts, which districts you come from, and then I come to you one by one to ask you, it will be quite time consuming when that data exists in admissions. The admission office, when you people were entering here, you were given a questionnaire where you were filling and putting all that information there. So now in admissions office in Uganda Christian University, has any data concerning your age, concerning the district you came from, concerning the schools you came from, concerning the grades which you scored, all that now is secondary data. We have it. So it's very, very bad to go and look for information which exists, now to go into primary sources to go and now start looking for it. So some of the existing sources for secondary data are survey records, experimental studies, those who have already done experiments, they have already put down what the findings are, internal records, that is employee records, production records, inventory records, sales records, credit records, and customer profile, etc. All those give us secondary data. Internet, such as that is websites, they give us secondary data. The only problem with the internet is that people post a lot of things which are not researched. Not researched. And that's why I wouldn't like you very much to depend on whatever you go that you go on Google. Google needs at least we have some which have authenticity, not going for any. Publications, I've already told you, we have publications, like newspapers. And newspapers, okay, good enough, they are recognized the publications. But the time spent on collecting information, analyzing it, and then presenting it is very narrow. And therefore, the sample which is used in these publications of newspapers is not representative enough. For example, if they come to ask as to whether Mubiru Richard students have perceived the lecture of business statistics, the first lecture, have they perceived it well, and ask only 3 people out of you who are over 100, that will be a very small sample. In fact, in sampling, we are saying The bigger the sample, the better the results. The bigger the sample. So if it was not time and money, we would be going in to ask each and every, or go in for records and take universal suffrage, whereby you could just go and count each and everything. But because of that, so publications, books, there are some people also who write books and they don't go through publications. They don't take them for publications. To publication, because I've already told you there is already existing group of people who are of repute, who know those things, who read it through and authenticate that this book is ready and it's a true record and his findings are okay, the statistics, the references which are used, there is no plagiarism. Plagiarism means copying other people's works and you claim to be yours. So all those are done. So these publications, yes, but they must be authenticated. They must be publications which are being allowed by recognized publishers. For primary data is just original source of information which does not exist anywhere. It doesn't exist anywhere. It hasn't been written by any person. It is original in nature, and the person who is going to use that information is the one who is looking for that information. So we use some methodologies like interviews. Interview people and get first-hand information. For example, if I want to know the diet each of you enjoys most, I don't think it is documented anyway. Apart from me picking up my gadgets and come and interview you and know your opinion. Opinions, findings are not written anywhere. So I will ask you which food, which dish would you want. Me as a Muganda, I enjoy matoke and chicken mostly. But then you cannot find it documented on my CV or anywhere. So you can't get it secondary, it's primary. Measurement, weighing, those ones, information which you want. For example, I want to know what is your height. I cannot get it anywhere. I just need to pick up my measurements and then come to know what's your weight and so on. Contingent evaluation method, which by use of questionnaire. So information got out of the questionnaire is primary in nature. So that is surveys, observations, especially scientists use it mostly. They use it observation method to come and collect primary data, primary information. Then data presentation is a way, one of the statistical methods. For secondary data, it is often already summarized, categorized, or tabulated. So for secondary data, you don't, that one is already, it's already done. It's done, it's already summarized. You get it, it's already in tables, it's already in a frequency distribution tables and so on. So that one, primary data, which already exists, is already made. But primary data, which uses raw data, is the one which needs to be processed to generate meaningful information to the users. So methods of data presentation. The tabulation method, you have to define what is a table. A table is made of rows and columns. It's made of rows and columns. And the information in the table must have a key for the units. It also must have a title. You don't just put there a table and you don't put a title. What does it represent? Down there, you must put the source of the information, source of data. If it is primary data survey, you just put its primary data survey. If you extracted a table from anywhere, you just put the source. And you don't increase because you don't want to own what you haven't done. Okay? So one of the methods of data presentation is the tabulation method, use of tables. and they shall come to do that. The graphical method. Graphical method, using graphs, you can represent data using graphs. And that is a bar graph. I would like you people to go and read and know the difference between a bar graph and a histogram. A bar graph, which type of information is represented on a bar graph, and which type of information is presented on a histogram. So you write those in your own notes, because what I told you, I'm not going to give you everything. Mine is only to lecture that is expose you to some of these key issues, and then you also do the rest. That reminds me of my edible headmaster when I was at HSC. He told us when we are during our induction time, when we had just joined the HSC, he told us that the school was going to give us 20% of what is required of us to pass. So the other 80% was totally ours, our own effort. So I really conceptualized that one right from the word go, knowing that even if I was seated before my teacher in HSC or mathematics, in economics or geography, which I did, which was my combination, I knew that those people were providing me 20%, and the other 80% my own effort. So even likewise, I'm telling you people, my students, 80% go Google, go to the library, read the books. But graphical method, what is it? What is the difference between this and that? So that by the time you come to the final exam, you are well equipped. And you can produce, not just generate or replicate what we have given you, but to show that you have come to the university and you have studied. You are well informed. So bar graph is that. The other is the histogram. And histogram is that is the shape. The other one is separated. The bars are separated. Here is compacted. That is graphical method. We have the line graph, that's using lines, blah blah blah. So you can represent information using line graph. And what I want you to go, these are statistics. Which type of information is represented on bar graph? Which type of information is represented on line graph? Which type of information is represented by a histogram? Then the pie charts. That one, I think, since the primary, you've been studying these pie charts. How do we come up with a pie chart? You know, you have information, for example, we want to assess the number of students who came from which regions, and we have come up with all the regions, Uganda, North, West, East, South, and so there's about five or central, six regions. You can just come up and say, oh, the regions, how many students are coming from there? You total them, and then you get each region divided by total times 360 degrees, which the pie chart comprises of 360 degrees. And then you come up with a portion of each region. What is the share? Which number of degrees are shared by each region? So that is using, now you're representing statistics using pie chart. So, we've begun with business statistics. I was on the introduction bit of it. We shall do the sum of the calculations. We shall make time. I want you to go and also read the sampling techniques, write your own notes, sampling procedures, write your own notes, and so that by the time we come, I'll come up with a formula of how to determine the sample, and then continue. So for today, I think that will suffice, and I wish you the best. If you have any question, I will have the WhatsApp group where you can put your question, and I will be ready to answer whatever you want me to answer. I wish you a good day. Thank you for listening.